Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions about Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. This week, it's the Hollywood Studios year by year. We're moving into 1942, and our first studio is Paramount. We'll be talking about a pair of road comedies. The first, Sullivan's Travels by Preston Sturges, and the second, an explicit road movie, Road to Morocco, directed by David Butler, if anyone cares about that. And stay tuned for Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto. We will be talking about three films this time out. TIFF has launched their Delphine Seyrig sampler, an extended sampler, and we saw the first three films this weekend. We saw a documentary by Seyrig herself, Sois belle et taisez-vous, then India Song by Marguerite Duras, and L'année dernière à Marienbad by Alain Resnais. We'll be getting into some potted discussions of those films, our takes on them, but we won't get too expansive because we do have India Song and Marienbad on the schedule for the future. And as always, let us look to Joel W. Findler and his amazing pink chart, which gives us the roster of stars at each studio in a given year. In The Hollywood Story, a hardcover that you must obtain in its first edition for these charts, don't forget, Findler always gives 1, 2, or 3 stars based on his impression of the value of each star to the studio during this period of their contract with it. So if you leave and come back, you risk losing a star factor, as we'll see on here. And if you're there for 20 years, well, he looks at the aggregate. This all seems to be part of Findler's calculations. So Veronica Lake, 2 stars. Betty Hutton, 3 stars. Alan Ladd, 3 stars. Bing Crosby, 3 stars. Ray Milland, 3 stars. Fred McMurray, 3 stars. Dorothy L'Amour, 2 stars. Bob Hope, 3 stars. Gary Cooper, back with the studio after a departure at the end of the 30s. He's got 3 stars still. Claudette Colbert, however, she's in her third stint with the studio and she's down to 2 stars, according to Findler. Susan Hayward, 1 star, and this was not a scintillating period for her. She was mostly playing other women and jerks, as she does in I Married a Witch. Paulette Goddard, 3 stars, and William Holden, 1 star. He will leave and come back to much greater renown at the end of the decade. Now, let's hear what John Douglas Eames has to say about Sullivan's Travels. The fourth and best picture from writer-director Preston Sturges, Sullivan's Travels went beyond his usual comedy field to explore dramatic realism in stark scenes on Skid Row and a prison farm. He wrote it specifically for Joel McRae, who used hitherto untapped acting resources to play a comedy director, tired of Hollywood trivia, disguising himself as a hobo, and going out to seek the grassroots of America to get material for a serious movie. In the end, he discovers that what the masses want and need most is laughter. They got plenty of that, along with the dramatic interludes from Sturges here, and even some romantic interest in a waif accompanying McRae, played by Veronica Lake, whom the director found hard to handle and blamed for sending the production 9 days over schedule. William Demarest, Eric Bloor, Margaret Hayes, Robert Warwick, Porter Hall, Esther Howard, Franklin Pangborn, and Robert Gregg were also in it. Paul Jones produced. Reviews were mixed and business disappointed, but it is now often cited as Sturges' masterpiece. Do you concur that it is his masterpiece?
Well, you know I don't, because I've already said that I had those feelings about The Lady Eve.
That's true, yes.
This viewing didn't change that. Didn't change my feelings about the film much. Maybe I've seen it 4 or 5 times now. I started out being really quite bored by it. I definitely appreciate it more now, but I haven't come around to it nearly as much as, say, I have on The Palm Beach Story, which might be my 3rd or 4th favorite now. I'm not crazy about preachy Sturges. When he enters this mode, he oddly seems more sentimental to me than Capra. I'm also not crazy about, although again, I appreciate it, especially love the structure of it, but I'm also not crazy about Hail the Conquering Hero. They give me the creeps.
But it's not preachy in any conventional sense. I mean, it is...
No, but it's heavy. There's something so heavy about it.
Okay, sure.
It doesn't move the way I want a Sturges comedy to move. In fact, the whole structure of it is designed for frustration. A journey where you keep getting pulled back to safety and comfort of home that you're trying to shake off.
Yeah, that's part of the genius of it. I feel like everyone agrees Veronica Lake is amazing in this movie.
No.
You don't like Veronica
Lake. No, not everyone agrees. I like her. But I just found, when I was glancing at the Wikipedia page, Diabolique magazine said in 2020, the girl, Veronica Lake, is captivating, magical, and extremely sexy. Whether sitting on McCrae's lap in a bathrobe and combing his hair, or walking along the road in a hobo overcoat. She wasn't great with all her dialogue, but Sturges made her spit it out at rapid-fire pace and protected her limitations. So that magazine can just fuck itself up the ass?
I don't understand that. She's hilarious. She's brilliant.
She's absolutely perfect with the dialogue. She's very funny in the way she delivers the line. I'm sorry, that is not all Preston Sturges.
No, she is a great comedian, and it's unfortunate that she didn't get a chance to do enough comedies.
Because... Sounds like she and Sturges deserved each other, because apparently everybody hated Veronica Lake. She tried to be as huge a pain in the ass as she possibly could, and Sturges loved to go into rages, violent rages, and so apparently when he found out she was 6 months pregnant and hadn't told him, he had to be restrained from physically attacking her.
Yeah, Veronica Lake, very hard to find anyone that had a great time working with her. She was even more of a problem than our, you know, just concluded actorist, Jean Arthur.
Or Margaret Sullivan, another of our faves.
Veronica Lake was legitimately, seriously mentally ill.
Well, so was Jean Arthur from what you've described.
Yeah, but she was able to function her whole life, and Veronica Lake was not, unfortunately. I mean, it's a really sad story. She's an amazing film presence, and I'm just delighted that she was able to stick it out as long as she did, and this is one of her best performances, for sure. So early on, too. And she looks amazing.
Did not guess. That was just my inattentiveness, but I did not guess that she was 6 months pregnant.
Well, they've got her in robes and men's clothes and just all kinds of baggy things that keep you from seeing any sort of a bulging middle. It works perfectly. Yeah, you wouldn't notice. You wouldn't think about it. As you say, Diabolique, I guess, has some kind of reservations about her performance, but most of the time, people are...
Well, no, it's just saying that whatever biography they read, just saying, she was limited, but you can't tell because Sturges covered it all up. That great genius.
Yeah, well, he did cover up the fact she was going to have a baby. That's what he did. And McCrae. You know, we've talked about Joel McCrae a lot.
Yeah, I feel like I shortchanged him when I was handing out best deliverers of Sturges dialogue. I think number one place still maybe tied between Barbara Stanwyck and Rudy Valley, but McCrae does do a wonderful job in this movie.
Yeah, and you know, he was Sturges' favorite actor, it seems to me, because he wrote this movie for him, he did the Palm Beach Story, then he did The Great Moment, also, I think, written specifically for Joel McCrae. Starts out, he wants to make this great movie of social significance.
Yeah, this is a great scene. Everybody does a very funny job in it, him and the lawyer and producer.
Well, Robert Warwick and Porter Hall, yes, they shoot holes in his bona fides for taking on this task.
By pretending that they're rags to riches.
Yeah, when really
stories.
There's no such thing.
As soon as I was, you know, because I didn't exactly remember the scene, as soon as I'm hearing them say this, my mind is loudly protesting, no studio heads were rags to riches stories by the 1940s. It was all nepotism. And of course, that's exactly what's revealed after Joel McCrae leaves the
Yeah.
Now, some of the original studio heads were self-made men in a new industry, right?
Well, they were mostly transitioning out of other very, very small enterprises, right? Mm-hmm. And you get the Nickelodeons as a big bridge point and stepping stone. But yeah, you're getting into further generations.
But what they tell him is that you don't know anything about suffering, which is certainly true of Preston Sturges himself.
Yeah, this is a self-portrait, clearly. I mean, Joel McRae is a little bit more of an impressive-looking human being than Preston Sturges, but other than that, it's a self-portrait.
Sure, it's the movie star self-portrait.
So then he hits upon this idea. Goaded on by their critique, he's like, you're right, I'm going out on the road. You know, it has this basis of realism. It understands how Hollywood works, and it expects us to understand that no studio is going to let a valuable director do this, so they bring in their counteroffer, which is that he can turn it into a bit of a roadshow exhibition.
There is, to some degree, like I said, there is this built-in, and it's similar to Hail the Conquering Hero, to which I said I also don't have a good reaction, despite admiring it. Both of them have structures of frustration. This has the feeling of, not that this is a show I watched a lot, but watching episodes of The Prisoner, as he keeps trying to escape from his own privilege and burst out of the bubble of representation into reality. He just, over and over again, he just can't manage to do it.
Yeah, I mean, it's an incredibly prescient work in that regard. It has a very postmodern aspect to it.
So, but I think we are supposed to feel a sense of frustration.
Of course, of course. We feel his frustration. He says several times, oh, it's probably Hollywood, wherever I've been dropped off here.
Hollywood comes to represent that, or does represent in the movie, that inability to escape from representation.
Yeah.
Into this imagined reality that is out there, but how can you actually apprehend it if you're not the misfortunate person yourself?
I think it's very clear in this film that no matter where he goes or what he doesn't escape into reality. He escapes into maybe another genre, but that's the best he can do, right? So you have kind of a potted history of Hollywood in this film. You've got silent comedy, Keystone Cops craziness with that Whippet tanker chase. You've got the romantic comedy. You've got the screwball comedy of the 30s, especially the meeting in the owl wagon and the stuff that goes on early on with Veronica Lake. Certainly later on, he gets into basically, I'm a fugitive from a chain gang.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, yeah, none of this. He enters a different kind of film, like he's suddenly fallen into an episode of The Twilight Zone.
Yes.
And the comedy turns into a nightmare. But it's still it's a total fantasy.
Yeah, and Sturges knows that, and he wants us to think about that. He's not obscuring that. He is not aiming for something that is real cinema vérité. Otherwise, he wouldn't go for, you know, the chain gang. I guess the closest we get to that are the hobo encampments that they hang out in. But even those
are... Oh, the music. The music is so syrupy.
Well, it is, and that's by design, too. A dirge that would be playing in some kind of revival house or tent that's pitched inside one of these encampments where people are trying to reclaim the souls of these unfortunates. So all of that is built into the narrative. It is saying, you know, what are the limitations that are placed upon an artist who you know, maybe desperately feels like they need to have a tangible impact on the real lives of the people they share their country with? Can it be done?
Also, just wanting to have personal authenticity.
Yeah. All these kinds of issues that are still very much at the forefront of artistic explorations in the 21st century, they're all here.
And certainly, unless you are an artist who has come from some terrible background, pretty much everyone feels this way. They don't have to be fabulously rich film directors who were raised with wealth, like Preston Sturges, in order to feel the exact same way about this.
Right.
Frank Capra, although he must have come from a middle-class situation if he was studying to be an engineer.
Yeah.
Nevertheless, had his aimless hobo period when he couldn't get any work after finishing his degree.
Yeah, I don't think that he wound up in the situations Joel McRae is in, but he was closer to it than Sturges ever got, for sure. I just like the intertext here, too, that, you know, a Paramount movie is referencing Capra. I mean, Capra has no involvement with Paramount, so, you know, they talk about Lubitsch a lot, too, but Lubitsch was a Paramount director, at least most of his career. That you kind of expect, but Sturges obviously insisted, I'm going to talk about Capra in this movie, even though it might promote, you know, a rival studio's product. and he's permitted to do it. I guess at this point they were permitting him to do just about anything.
But what movie has Capra made? Well, okay, I guess you could say that some misfortune is shown in It Happened One Night, in the prison scene in You Can't Take It With You. He certainly never devoted a whole movie to that.
Yeah, it's in segments, right? You've got the distraught farmers in Mr. Deeds and Meet John Doe, which came out in 1941 as well, certainly has a lot of discussion, and it is focused on all of these suffering people who are willing to come forward and pretend to be this John Doe figure. That would be the one that Sturges would be thinking of, I would think.
And the conclusion of the movie is that it's better to make silly comedies than message pictures, but that's the conclusion of a message picture.
Yeah.
And although Sturges, in all of his movies, is fascinated by slapstick, he never really does just make a silly comedy. He never does.
No, of course not. And that's not what he's advocating overall, I don't think. That's not where your mind as a viewer would land, whatever Joel McRae's character is saying.
You don't think so?
No, I definitely don't think so.
Can we talk about, before we get into final conclusions about what the movie is saying, do you want to jump right into the final sequence, or do you want to discuss anything, you know, when he goes to the prison, or do you want to discuss anything in more detail before that?
I could talk about this movie for hours, well, but we probably shouldn't.
Just go ahead. We've got lots of time. We're only doing two full movies.
I think there's just so much to be said, even about, you know, all the little character actor performances here. Some of the stuff that happens early on. Robert Grigg, the butler, talks about how poverty is a virulent plague that must be avoided. Whatever he's saying, I don't agree with this.
No, but it's the idea that's the idea that there is just nothing that can be done to make the world better. And therefore, if you happen to find yourself in a position of privilege,
enjoy it.
Enjoy it. Be happy that that's you, and don't even put it at risk by or compromise it in any way by even thinking about anything else.
But the other thing he says, which is related, which is that, you know, the people who are thinking about this, theorists, are usually rich people. The morbid rich are curious about poverty and how the other half lives.
I think both there and there are other points in the movie where the idea of poverty porn that we talk about now, like, it's basically the same thing. Even if you did succeed in making a picture about suffering, who are you? No, I think this is a real question. Who are you making it for? Is it just going to be other people like you? Is it really going to motivate them to change anything? Are they capable of changing anything? The people who will be sympathetic to your message? Or are they just going to gape at it?
Standing behind all of these discussions is the example, I guess, that everyone probably is hoping to follow in, which is Charles Dickens, who did explore, you know, so many aspects of Victorian society, but one aspect that he returned to again and again is the plight of the people left behind, the people suffering in this London and this England that is surging ahead in its glory days. And, you know, a tangible impact of what he does is, you know, debtor's prison is removed based on Dickens', you know, rabble-rousing novel.
Sure, and Uncle Tom's Cabin. Yes, yeah. That's another example of a politically influential book, which is, of course, itself a complete fantasy?
Well, yeah, and it's, again, she's following in Dickens' footsteps. She's trying to tell a very entertaining story that at the same time motivates people to political action, and she succeeded, right? She did help to galvanize the North in the feeling that slavery is something that did need to be opposed, at least in some small respect.
So this can work. So, I mean, I suppose it's worth a try if it can work, but the vast majority of the time it doesn't.
No, of course not.
And it doesn't actually really matter if you're a rich person writing about suffering, or if you're a person who's experienced it writing about it and it's published or produced by a rich person. It really doesn't make any difference to whether it actually galvanizes people to effective political action, or they just feel good that they watched this play or this movie or read this book and that's as far as it goes, and, you know, they don't want to do anything too radical with their voting.
Yeah, they felt another person's pain. It's hard to think of a movie that has ever had the kind of impact that we know Dickens and Stowe had. I mean,
so the only movie that even attempts anything like that, I think, is Chain Gang.
I guess you're right. The chain gang system was moderated or even abolished in some states during the years following that movie. Mm-hmm. Most of the time when I can think of movies that have had a serious sociological impact, they wind up being really negative or horrifying, like The Birth of a Nation, which led to the rebirth of the Ku Klux Klan.
Capra movies aren't even attempting to galvanize anybody to political action.
No, they're explicitly against doing that, right? They're trying to galvanize people to get together and help each other and not rely on the government.
Which is harder than getting them to vote effectively.
It's very suspicious of things like that, right? That's what Meet John Doe is all about.
What Capra movies are doing, and what I guess so is this movie doing, they are thinking through issues that are of importance to the people making them. And is that not all that we can hope a movie will do?
Well, yeah.
In order to be interesting?
Yes, that's why I think Sullivan's Travels is a masterpiece, because it takes us through the roller coaster of emotions and thoughts that a person in Preston Sturges' position would be experiencing in the early 1940s, placed in this situation where his studio thinks he is, you know, the golden artist of his time. They're letting him do anything he wants for a few years here, even allowing him a little setback like Sullivan's Travels, which was not setting the world on fire at the box office. He kept going with the Bracken movies, which did incredibly well. You know, what is he going to use this podium for?
I guess my issue is that as much as I'm interested in watching Preston Sturges think, I'm more interested in watching a well-made comedy by Preston Sturges.
If we have a divide, that's where it is. Because I find
I find like the perfect combination of the two is probably The Miracle of Morgan's Creek, which is why it's my second favorite Preston Sturges movie.
All the Paramount movies are great, including The Great Moment, I think.
I would also put The Lady Eve above any of Capra's thought pieces. So that's just where my choice lies, the kind of movie I'd rather see. Now, they're all great movies, and I'd like to see them all. I have enough time in my life to do that.
For me, this movie literally has everything, at least a little bit of everything I want in a movie. And that seems to me to be what he was trying to do. I mean, it's kind of like a David Lynch extravaganza, but in all taking place in 90 minutes. I mean, as I was saying before, it gives you all these different dips into different genres, and masterfully done each time, I think. You know, the stuff with McRae and Veronica Lake is some of my favorite screwball comedy stuff that exists, and it doesn't take up that much of the movie, but it's really just incredible, the rapport that they build.
Yeah, and they hated each other.
Doesn't matter. It's great on the screen. You know, that scene in the owl lunch wagon, I just love it. It's one of my favorite scenes ever. All these other little one-off encounters, even before he meets Veronica Lake, his weird hostage situation with Esther Howard.
Oh, right. I guess that's another kind of distant reference to Chain Gang, where Paul Mooney is entrapped by his landlady. She's younger, but she's no nicer. She's no better.
I found these, you know, this couple here, Esther Howard and her sister, they seem to be mirror universe evil versions of Beulah Bondi and Elizabeth Patterson. Sure. In Remember the Night.
And Joel McRae terrified that he's going to get turned into that dead husband.
Yeah.
Over the mantelpiece.
Yeah, it's crazy. I mean, so many of these amazing little interludes and just a little passing commentary.
Oh, and I love the fact that when they take him out to the movies, this wealthy picture director, the scene really communicates how it makes his skin crawl even to be near ordinary people.
Whatever he thought people were doing when they were watching his movies, he did not think it was like this, right? They're not paying attention at all half the time.
They're loudly eating snacks.
Not dominating people's attention the way clearly he hopes it will.
No, you have to put people in prison for that.
The scene where they show up and they try to get coffees and McRae doesn't even have the dime he thought he had, and they have this sort of poignant moment with the cafe owner who gives them some food anyway,
yeah,
and then they
like
give
that.
Him $100, and publicist, the woman that's on the land yacht, says that guy's gonna go bankrupt, he's gonna give away food to everyone who comes in, and he's never gonna get another prize for doing it, right?
You can never know the consequences of your actions. That's why ethics is complicated.
It's shot through with real emotional moments of generosity and empathy for our fellow beings, and also, you know, Sturges' cynicism about the limits of that, ways that we can all lead each other astray. And
also, those donuts just look so good. I want a free donut.
Vegan donuts. We're always walking by that place. What about this marriage? What a crazy plot that is. Like, that could be a movie in itself. He's married to this woman for taxes, And then she decides to stick him.
You want to see that movie?
Maybe not.
That's your kind of movie?
No, not really. But just, that's a crazy plot.
Well, she seems like a 1930s Warner Brothers wife.
Yeah, but worse. I don't know. I've never heard of anything like this in a movie.
Or ex-wife, I should say.
And that's the go-to jerk, that actress. I don't know her name, but she's one of the main people trying to get Hopsy. She's one of the people that Barbara Stanwyck is watching through her mirror.
Jane Buckingham. Well, the whole sequence of the tramps community.
It's an extended montage.
Once the music finally stops, thank God, then you get the scene of Veronica Lake and Joel McRae sleeping rough with these other tramps. I like that a lot because, again, you can just, the uncomfortableness of having no privacy and no boundaries, and you can just smell everybody in the scene.
Share so everybody's fleas.
That does communicate a lot about not suffering, not grandiose suffering, but indignity and, yeah, I mean, just the indignity of the situation.
Yeah. No, it's
discomfort.
I think it's pretty nicely judged. It definitely hits the middle class viewer, you know, where they live by showing them, you know, even their worst nightmare about what it is to not have a place to live. They can't even really imagine what it would be like. You know, this just gives you a little taste.
But this is where the shoes get exchanged.
Then we get this crazy deviation into proto-noir. Again, we're very early in the emergence of the noir style and noir cycle. Bash on the head, and then follow the perpetrator of that crime, who is just so drunk with the windfall that has come to him that he just can't hang on to it. He
runs over that giant sequence of tracks.
Like, what this movie is saying is probably the starkest thing in the film, right? You have to try to keep that money. Worse to get off those train tracks without the money. You may as well just get hit by a train if you can't get that money. Again, side story that's not explored in depth. This movie is 90 minutes long and a lot happens in it.
Well, at this point, it is a Twilight Zone episode in which Joel McRae, through the age-old dramatic device of an belonging that has some identifying feature on it, literally loses his identity, and only by doing so is he actually able to escape from safety.
Yeah, and he wakes up in a train yard, and we see how people in his position are treated by the railroad employees. He's pushed around, he's discombobulated, doesn't know who he is, he strikes out, or lashes out. He has a rock, breaks this guy's face, doesn't kill him, but does a lot of damage and is hauled into court. We see Willard Robertson, the judge who in Remember the Night was the long-winded lawyer. Here he is barking out instructions about locking Joel McRae up for not the maximum period of time, but 6 years. Joel McRae is starting to come out of it at the end of that, but everything's shot in a subjective fog.
So this is very much, I mean, it definitely could be a noir plot. The idea that you're being wrongfully imprisoned, the justice system is against the little man.
Yeah. Some of the most trenchant social criticism that we get in this film comes out of McRae's mouth inadvertently as he tells Jimmy Conlon.
Studio directors don't get put away for things like this.
Yeah, exactly. And you know, obviously he's 100% correct, and therein lies so much of the injustice of the system. And Jimmy Conlon is like, well, maybe that's because you're not a studio director. I love that.
Maybe that's just an idea that came into your head when it got hit.
Yeah, I love that performance. I mean, again, he's one of the many Sturges veterans that's, you know, in all of the movies.
So he's somebody at the prison?
He's a trustee. Right, I think that's what they call him in the credits. It must be, because I know he's the trustee. I've seen this movie a lot of times. Well, he's a prisoner who has distinguished himself by good behavior, so he's given special duties, but he's a prisoner as well. He's not just a guard.
Right. The movie even has sympathy for the warden.
Yeah, Al Bridge, great actor. He's also in It's a Wonderful Life, right? He's the sheriff who is counting up the receipts at the end of the movie and finally decides that he's just going to join in the chorus. And that's what happens in this movie, too. He is just as much, or almost as much, of a prisoner on this horrible compound as the people that are under his
heel. Yeah, that's why he's allowed to laugh with them at the movie. I mean, the point is clearly that wardens are also victims of the system.
Certainly they're not at the top of it, right?
Well, I mean, even just in the sense, it's not a Sancho the Bailiff type of point, but, you know, in the same sense that you might say that patriarchy harms everybody. He's been made into a monster.
Yeah.
He's not inherently a monster.
No, of course not. Everyone can laugh at Pluto getting being stuck on flypaper.
Now, this is what's fascinating, because we've had this... I mean, we should talk about the highly, effectively sentimental presentation, but also very uncharacteristically humanizing presentation of the Black Church for the period.
It contrasts sharply with the ways in which Sturges has used Black actors in other moments in his films, and indeed even in this film, in the land yacht chase sequence, the cook gets the worst of the slapstick beatings.
It's an actor by the name of Charles Moore. But the very fact that he presents these two different genres, one of which, like I said, wouldn't be common to see in a 1940s Hollywood movie, the Black Church with actual people with dignity in it, shows an awareness of how Charles Moore's character is being used.
I think we have to think about
this.
I
don't know if there's an awareness, a conscious thesis in Preston Sturges' head, or he's just good at juxtaposing genres as a storyteller and filmmaker would be, but the awareness comes out of the movie.
We don't have to go so far as to attribute intentionality in all of his uses or his writing of a demeaning stereotype in other movies or in this one.
Like, we've talked about this issue with Black comedians at the time, what kind of types were available, and the fact that these people were professional comedians. Sturges does talk in his autobiographical writings about Black comedians that he saw on the stage as a kid and how they were among his favorites, and he profoundly admired them as artists, right? So this character in his head that gets into his movies, I mean, that came, it was one of his ideas of what comedy could be, you know, like one of the achievements of comedy, according to him. But yeah, in this movie in particular, there are these two contrasting genres presented, and one is very humanizing and one is completely dehumanizing, right down to the point of whiteface.
Yeah.
That whole sequence where Charles Moore gets the worst of it, of all of the slapstick going on in that van.
As they chase the Whippet tanker.
Yeah, that's the movie's own version of the Mickey Mouse cartoon, and Charles Moore is Pluto.
Yeah.
So, and what's Pluto? What is everybody laughing at when they're laughing at this comedy? They're laughing at suffering.
Yeah.
They're laughing at a dehumanized cartoon dog at the end, scapegoat.
That they know will be okay for the next cartoon, but...
But still...
Nevertheless,
it's one kind of suffering looking at another kind of differently presented suffering, and that's what pure comedy is, a different perspective on suffering.
Yes.
And that's really a fascinating place for the movie to end up on, and it's also fascinating for Sturges as an auteur, because his comedies repeatedly explore this idea of slapstick and how it's related to suffering, and how the comedies themselves move back and forth between real pain and a comedic distance from it that's hilarity, right?
Yeah.
So basically, there is no way to get away from suffering, in other words.
No, absolutely not.
It's absolutely at the heart of every kind of art.
So what Joel McRae is really saying at the end of this film is that he's going to make films about suffering from a different angle than he intended to when he wanted to make Oh Brother, Where Art Thou.
But what were you going to say about its message not being that what we should really do is make silly comedy?
I don't think that that is where the center of gravity of this film really lands, because as we've seen, this movie does everything. And most Sturges movies, in some way or other, do everything. He never, as you say, never makes just a pure Pluto comedy, right? He's always got a range of emotions involved. He's always got more than just someone getting stuck on a flypaper.
And even the slapstick is always brought to the point of real pain. Like, that's the cathartic climax of The Lady Eve, where we may still feel like she should endlessly make Henry Fonda's insufferable character suffer, but she herself decides, no, it's time to stop and take a different approach. Because I could just keep doing this forever. I'm going to get bored.
If there is anything to be taken propositionally from the ending of the film, I think you could say that Sturges is saying that every director, in his mind anyway, every artist, every storyteller, should be trying to entertain people in some way, rather than trying to use film consciously as the educational and sociological medium that it is.
Yeah, but who's actually doing that other than documentarians?
Well, that's exactly it. But nobody.
But it's his own feeling of, I should be doing this. Like,
that's right.
It's an inner pressure. Like, nobody's actually doing that, but he feels like, maybe I should. Maybe what I'm actually doing is silly and worthless.
A straw man. And as we saw, like, the thing that Joel McRae is showing to the studio heads at the beginning of the film, right? We start with...
Capital and labor are going to destroy each other.
Yeah, that does look stupid. right? I don't want to see that movie. Capital and labor destroy each other by fighting on top of a train. So he's right to abandon that plan, I think, you know, and he can't make movies in that mindset. And I think that that's true. Sturges does believe ultimately, or he's trying to communicate that what an artist needs to do is involve people in a different way than that movie was aiming to do, or that snippet of a movie was aiming to do. But I don't think in any way that he is trying to limit himself or paint himself into a corner. And we see that he certainly doesn't, because the movies that he makes after this go all over the place. And they certainly involve their viewers at every level of human consciousness and emotion. I guess we'll leave Sullivan's Travels here. Let us know what you think of it. If you've never seen it before and you're experiencing it for the first time, I would love to know how it struck you. One thing that I do want to end on, I guess, is, you know, knowing my obsession with King Vidor, I'm sure you can see this coming, but the crowd is, you know, if I was trying to intuit or invent a movie watching backstory, you know, the way we do with David Lynch all the time, like, oh yeah, he's definitely influenced by this movie that he never talks about. Now, I haven't read enough of Sturges' own discussions of his film going, but to me, the crowd, I think, is his favorite movie. That's my guess. We've got, you know, direct visual swipes from the crowd in Christmas in July. And this one too, you know, it ends, or it almost ends, right? We've got the coda where Joel McRae says, and I say it with some embarrassment and all that stuff, but it does go back to that. The crowd ends with the restored family, what's left of it, laughing at a vaudeville act, right? And that is sort of Vidor bringing our lonely, isolated figure back into the crowd as a member of the public, enjoying comedy. And this is what Sturges is doing with his characters in this movie too. Someone has to have written on that.
So this seems like a good juxtaposition, because now we're turning to a movie with, because I was just saying, fascinating as movies are, where the director has a lot on his mind, I'd probably prefer a comedy that doesn't have anything on its mind. And here we've got one. I wouldn't say I necessarily preferred it to Sullivan's Travels, but it was pretty fun.
Well, this is a movie that owes nothing to King Vidor's The Crowd. Road to Morocco. Let's hear what John Douglas Eames had to say in the Paramount story. Bing Crosby and Bob Hope were off on the road to Morocco, and everybody was happy. Their third annual Skylark started with them shipwrecked on a Mediterranean beach and finished with them on a raft floating into New York Harbor with a couple of beauties picked up en route. In between was a wild spoof of all the Arab movies ever made, and an occasional respite from the boys' incessant clowning in Dorothy L'Amour as a Moroccan princess to whom Bing warbled Moonlight Becomes You, which gave him another bestseller. The Paul Jones production looked lavish, and director David Butler managed to keep the Oscar-nominated Don Hartman Frank Butler, no relationship to the director, but an Oxford graduate Englishman specializing in Hollywood comedies, Frank Butler's script, on course while Bing and Bob gagged it up. In the cast, Anthony Quinn, Donna Drake, Vladimir Sokolov, Mikhail Rasumny, George Givut, Andrew Tomes, and the sultry Yvonne DiCarlo, who became a star in the kind of films this one kidded. It was an even bigger hit than Road to Zanzibar.
Now, I say this comedy has nothing on its mind, and it doesn't, but it shows you how comedy itself can think as a genre, because this movie does not need Edward Said to know what Orientalism is, for example.
No, that's true. Now, this movie, I was expecting a lot from you on it, because it's clear, you know, these road movies lie behind the Martin and Lewis movies, and
yeah,
certainly
yeah.
They explicitly, we know this, they definitely are on Elaine May's mind as well, because Ishtar is an homage to this, but
yeah.
Really, this movie has as dark a vision of male friendships as Mikey and Nikki does. These guys hate each other from the very start. I mean, Bing
yeah.
Crosby is talking about eating Bob Hope, and he's not really kidding either.
This movie is pretty much endlessly fascinating. It's, like a very long essay could come out of me on this, or anybody on this movie.
Someone has to have written on how utterly amoral this is. These are fucking monsters, these people.
Okay. Whoa, there's a lot to unpack here. Before we get into all of that, how did you enjoy the movie?
Well, it's not really the kind of thing that I'm gonna love, you know, because I just hate these guys. It certainly gives a lot of food for thought. I really enjoyed thinking about talking about it with you.
I thought it was very fun. I don't know, 3 out of 4 stars fun. It's supposed to be their best. Second best is supposedly Road to Utopia, and you know...
That's the one I saw, because Robert Benchley narrates it.
Yeah, what did you think of that one? Is it good?
I don't remember. Oh, okay. I saw it when I was a teenager.
Oh, okay. Because I thought you would have rewatched it because of Benchley, but...
We will one day watch it.
Because these movies were a phenomenon, and they were considered, I mean, they're hugely popular, but they also were considered to be sophisticated comedies. Sophisticated in their...
Zaniness, like in Hell's a Poppin' sense.
Yeah, in their understanding of their own stupidity, or the basicness of the comedy structures on which towers of meta are imposed.
Well, the Road to Morocco song at the beginning is the ultimate meta song. I mean, they talk about how they're probably going to meet Dorothy L'Amour.
It's basically just a comedy sketch stretched into movie length.
And you know that they're not playing the same characters, right? Every movie, they're different characters.
Yeah.
So they start from scratch. And I don't know if they're reprehensible towards each other in all of them, but this was just endlessly backstabbing each other.
Mm-hmm. Apparently in some cases, later on, they will develop memories of their other movies, though.
Right, okay.
Even though they do play other characters.
Well, in this one, they do too, right? Because I haven't seen the movie they're referencing, but clearly when they try that patty cake gag, it doesn't work out. And they're like, oh, that got around pretty quickly, right? So Anthony Quinn knows what's coming and reacts.
Bob Hope is really funny. Seems to anticipate Jack Lemmon a lot more than I expected. Less hyperactive, though.
Yeah, he's a cowardly nebbish.
Yeah.
I mean, that's his shtick. I prefer him in something like The Ghost Breakers, a movie I actually really enjoy.
That's a movie that Martin and Lewis actually remade.
So Sullivan's Travels definitely falls more in the Dave column, and this one clearly...
No, I don't think I liked it better than Sullivan's Travels.
No, but this is where your expertise can really come in handy.
I like them both a lot. I like both movies a lot. I like The Lady Eve better than either movie.
If fandom had existed in the way it does now, there would have been lots of Bing and Bob slash fiction.
Well, there probably already was some fandom of some kind for this.
The movie is basically just homosexual panic for 90 minutes.
One thing I wanted to get out of the way was, speaking of scapegoating plots in Sturges and how they're related to comic structures in general, we've got another explicit scapegoating plot here, and I guess it's been so long since I watched a comedy with a plot this basic that I couldn't believe I didn't see what was coming for Bob Hope's character. I couldn't believe that plot twist actually took me by surprise, but it's the most generic of scapegoating plots and dramatic structures, which is the...
Sacrificial king?
Sacrificial king. Yeah, absolutely. And then they take turns trading places as the sacrificial king until they manage to get out of the situation.
These guys are mass murderers. We definitely can't leave aside.
Yeah.
Bob Hope has destroyed 2 ships full of people in this movie.
Yeah. So that's how they start out. And already that's really a radical positioning of these comic characters.
The code does not apply, apparently, in this kind of movie.
Absolute, chaotic, nihilistic cranks.
If a camel talks, no one has to go to jail. Clearly that's the Breen office's opinion on this.
So yeah, they're agents of chaos, and they are not likable.
No.
And they don't like each other.
No.
This movie made me start reflecting again on a question that's come up many times on the podcast, because it's a question that quite interests me, which is, what is a double act? Because even though Hope and Crosby were only a double act in these movies, they are definitely very much written as a classic double act. Where does the double act originate? That's what I'd like to know. Obviously in the music hall in vaudeville, but does it somehow extend back further than that? I don't know. You don't really find it in written down dramas. I'm not aware of any commedia dell'arte.
Did they never have double jesters or double fools?
Not that I'm aware of.
There's always just one fool at court.
I don't know, maybe it really is just an invention of the music hall and vaudeville. You know that the double act pretty much just goes away in American film because everything, old forms of entertainment are completely blasted away in the 1960s.
Well, replaced by the
buddy film.
Yeah.
Which will come up again later in this episode, probably.
I mean, this is a buddy film.
It is also a buddy film, but
with
it's kind of
a lot less tenderness between the buddies than you get in the classic 60s and 70s formulation.
Segue from one form to the other, from the double act to the buddy movie. In England, on the other hand, there's less of a decisive break from older forms of entertainment in the 1960s, and the double act continues. One of them I'm familiar with from
Peter Cook and Dudley Moore.
Well, I'm thinking of as late as the 2000s, which is The Mighty Boosh.
Oh, yeah.
Those characters pretty much hate each other, too. It's always, and you know, Bert and Ernie, everyone's familiar with that. Like, how are these two people friends?
Well, yeah, but they're, you know,
two puppets.
So often it's about, you know, they love each other, but they're frustrated by each other, like the Odd Couple. Like, these guys don't have that. They don't love each other. They hate each other.
Yeah,
they're actively
somehow
trying to kill each other quite often.
They are, but they also somehow do love each other. I mean, that's got to be understood as part of the double act. It's got to be why there's this asexual sexual tension between them. It's like the hatred is this sexual tension.
Right, they want to get rid of this guy that they've got these thoughts about.
I don't know, but this is, yeah, the most intense version of the hate side of the love-hate relationship. But it's always a love-hate relationship. In the Martin and Lewis movies, and apparently this is true in most of these movies of Bing Crosby's character, usually he is the most conniving one, and Bob Hope's character is
more of a dope.
The Patsy, the dupe. But Jerry Lewis's character is very much more sentimentalized in the movies than Bob Hope's character is, obviously.
Probably the thing I find most interesting about Hope and Crosby is that they're not really playing very easily distinguished characters.
Yeah, I know. They really are doubles.
This is not an Odd Couple. No. One of them can sing better than the other one.
Yeah,
that's about it.
The crooner is a little bit more, yeah, of a plotter and a deceiver, but there's very, very little distinction. And there aren't, usually in the double act, there are two very well-defined opposite characters.
Yeah, like Laurel and Hardy is the classic.
Yeah, or Bert and Ernie, or the characters in The Mighty Boosh. They're opposites. One is a nerd, one is cool, narcissistic, whatever.
Yeah.
And one kind of needles the other, but none of that is true here. These are just about identical characters, but a little bit distinguished in terms of familiar stereotypes. But in this movie, anyway, Crosby initially gets it over on Bob Hope, but then they just spend the rest of the movie giving it to each other until they have to band together against a common enemy.
Yeah.
Right? And rescue the girls, but even they do rescue the girls, but then the girls also kind of rescue them back.
Yeah, I mean, Dorothy L'Amour participates quite a bit in the setup, right?
That's
She's
true.
The one that puts the whoopee cushion thing underneath the rival. She is the third member of this road trio.
Yep, she's in all the movies. We saw her in...
We've seen her in a few things.
We saw her in Johnny Apollo. That's where she really...
She's wonderful in that. She's also terrific in Disputed Passage.
Yeah, that was a very good dramatic performance, but she is also a very unique kind of femme fatale with a great singing voice in Johnny Apollo.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm sure she made a lot of money doing these movies, probably not the best use to which her talents could be put.
As you see in Joel Findler's ratings, she's a 2-star and Hope and Crosby are the 3 stars, so she doesn't get the spotlight as much as they do. You know, they find little bits for her. Donna Drake is an interesting performer as well. She sort of sneaks up on you in this movie and winds up being the 4th member of the quadrangle or whatever, although she only has eyes for Bob Hope for whatever reason. I've seen her in a few things. She has a pretty memorable performance in The Girl from Jones Beach, which is a pretty dumb movie that I watched for the Red Time for Bonzo podcast, the Ronald Reagan podcast. She is paired up with Eddie Bracken in that movie, and they've got some pretty good comedy beats in it. So yeah, she seems to have been pigeonholed as, you know, a beautiful woman who winds up being the love interest of a goofball and as a second lead, because Bracken is paired with her, Reagan is paired with Virginia Mayo. Here, Bing and Dorothy L'Amour are the A couple, and Donna Drake and Bob Hope are the B couple.
There are some stunningly edgy and modern moments in this movie. I guess, yeah, they were just getting away with an awful lot in this movie that should not have been allowed under the code, but I guess because it's zany comedy, it's okay. Such as Bob Hope's exclamation, "Why would a man want to buy another man?" I mean, it's just very adult at moments, this movie. Then there was the whole, what looked like it was going to be a very uncomfortable, in today's terms, joke about intellectually disabled people.
Well, it's still uncomfortable. Let's not go too far.
True, but it does have a twist ending where Bob Hope's impersonation backfires on him.
Yeah, because the seller that they try to bamboozle has the very accent or whatever.
Speech impediment, shall we say?
That they landed upon.
But I mean, yeah, I guess you basically hit the nail on the head in that what's unique about the movie is, besides the fact that the characters aren't very distinguished from each other, just their unmitigated nastiness to each other and in general.
They just destroy anything they touch, and they're going all around the world doing it to various cultures and cities and places.
And I mean, I guess it kind of works considering that these are all road trip movies, and I guess they're all making fun of movie genres, and that is a connection to Sullivan's Travels, this idea of the absurdity of Hollywood's representations.
Yes.
One thing that does come across is that they're ugly Americans.
Yes. Yeah,
really, really, really ugly Americans, and everything that happens to them, this whole setup where Bob Hope's character is going to be sacrificed, they totally deserve it, and you want to see him get it. And at the same time, of course, because,
well,
for the interest of the plot, you also want to see them get out of it.
Well, and as you hear in the film, they talk about how everyone knows they're going to be fine because they're both under contract for another 7 years to Paramount.
Well, yeah, they are actually Pluto.
Yeah.
Not like Charles Moore's cook, who's not a big movie star, and we don't know that he's going to be fine and show up again in many more movies. These guys really are Pluto.
Although it is mitigated by the fact that every road movie, they play a different pair of men who hate each other. I mean, I think that's what it is. Maybe some of them are more convivial.
I think you probably are onto something too with the homosexual panic and its connection to the two men's unmitigated hatred for each other, only mediated for the sake of the plot by Bob Hope's granny act as this dead aunt.
She's a Republican.
That it's kind of like both sexual tension, this mutual hatred, and a desire to, yeah, destroy the other man before it can turn into something sexual.
Yeah.
I don't know. And I'm sure you noticed in that whole Great Desert Mirage section, which I loved. I just loved the way that looked. The Mirage burger joint in the middle of the desert.
And then Dorothy L'Amour appears.
And everybody exchanges singing voices, and the genders get all mixed up, and it ends with...
Well, they try to kiss her, and they wind up kissing each other.
Because she's a Mirage. And I mean, I'm sure you can see how Frank Tashlin takes that idea and expands it into the whole range of gender confusion that we talked about in our Artists and Models episode, right?
Yeah. And Donna Drake certainly is playing the Shirley MacLaine character in this one, right? Just inexplicably obsessed with this complete moron, Bob Hope, just for the sake of a plot to give him some other woman to wind up with instead of Bing.
Well, and Artists and Models actually lampshades that by Shirley MacLaine deciding to get obsessed with Jerry Lewis's character because of astrology, because of her horoscope.
Horoscopes play a large role in this film as well.
That's true, they do. Every joke, every plot twist joke is incredibly stupid, but like delivered with such panache. I guess my favorite being the way that they escape from the prison.
First, they get a magic ring that won't work for everyone. It won't work for Bing. Then Bob Hope stumbles upon the fact that it will, but he's such an idiot and goofus.
Well, you could see that coming from a billion miles away.
Course.
It's the Three Wishes folktale.
Yeah, he just wastes them all.
Yeah.
Then they manage to get out of their predicament anyway by finding someone who's even dumber than them, who happens to be guarding their cell. They ask him to recount the last time someone broke out, and he reenacts it for them all the way to the point of handing over his gun.
And the women in these two comic scapegraces, I mean, ultimately, their ugly Americanism is overshadowed by this patriarchal threat that they get to band against with the women that kind of by default turns them into heroic characters.
Slightly better option.
Underdog.
I mean, I really love the way Dorothy L'Amour plays the early scenes. I think she's great in this movie as much as she gets to do. I mean, where she is buttering up Bob Hope, and you think that she's sort of inexplicably enthralled by him the way Donna Drake really is, but she's not. She is doing all of this as a gambit so that she can find herself a man who can die in the spot that has been appointed by the stars. Vladimir Sokolov is her soothsayer or astrologer who makes a mistake because the telescope needs cleansing. All of that is great, but then she really does fall in love with Bing Crosby, I guess because of his singing voice, so that's something that is remarkable about him, but everything else about him is reprehensible, and she knows that he has sold his friend into slavery. She still somehow is in love with him. It's a little bit hard to believe, but yeah, the movie does ask you to go with it, and it works. It's chaotic enough that you just let it all unfold.
Well, nothing has to really be believed too hard, because everything is just a highlighted, highlighted movie convention anyway. Like I said, the movie implicitly shows an awareness that Hollywood's representations of foreign countries are absurd.
Yes.
And foreign peoples. Yeah, I don't know. I don't really have any extra commentary to add.
The talking camels?
Well, the talking camels are just there to...
This is the screwiest picture I've ever been in.
The talking camels are there to serve a very specific function, which is at the climax of the movie that you're watching, and you're a kid, and you're in the theater, and you're watching this movie with all these other people, and this is the climax, and they're going to do all these pranks that are going to end up with everything exploding and chaos. The camels are just there to encourage people to laugh more. They're like a comic chorus.
Yeah, for sure.
They're just there to heighten the comic mood. It didn't work in our bedroom, watching it on our computer, but but I could see how it could work.
Well, I knew they were coming, because that's the thing you always read about this movie, like the camels talk, so.
Right.
I'm sure at the time, it was much more unexpected.
They are there to heighten the festive mood.
Have you ever seen How's a Poppin'?
No.
Because that was a huge phenomenon in 1941, where all kinds of stuff like this happens, I think. I haven't seen it. I think we've got it on our schedule at some point for Universal 1941, the next time around.
I mean, what it shows you in the end, and we can bring this back around to the Lady Eve and your problem with the tremendous unpleasantness of both of the characters in that movie, main characters, and the nature of their romance. It's a very naked example of just how unpleasant comedy really is.
Absolutely. And on that level, I found it really interesting.
And it's exhilarating. It's exhilarating that you're not in any way being coerced to care about these characters and want bad things to happen to them. And they're stars, so that's even funnier.
Yeah, it's sort of following the Seinfeld.
Maybe. But that's not like the Martin and Lewis movies. You want them to find a way to reconcile because Lewis's character is always sentimentalized.
Those movies really care about the love between those guys.
Yeah.
This, the love between Hope and Crosby is very subterranean.
Dark and murky. Why would a man want to buy another man?
That's Paramount 1942. Let's talk about the Delphine Seyrig, the first three parts of it. So the documentary, Sois belle et taisez-vous, Be Pretty and Shut Up.
I was really not looking forward to this. I really did not want to see a second wave feminist documentary. I thought it would be preachier than it was, though, and it wasn't, so that's good. I just don't like preachiness, Dave.
No.
Ever. Really against it. I mean, it was just interview footage. What we saw was a restored version of...
This is the best it's ever going
to
look.
This is the best it's ever going to look. A lot of work was done to the images and sound. This was the America's debut. We saw it before Europe. This is the kind of thing that we go to TIFF for. Apparently this is available for streaming, but not the restored version. You can find it streaming online in its original degraded form.
Yes, as one of our audience members commented.
We should say what it was. It's a bunch of interviews with actresses of the day, many of them very well known to us even now.
Either French or North American actresses.
Yeah. Answering Delphine Seyrig's questions about what it is like to be a woman in the business.
Yeah. And it starts out with some more directed questions, and then it gets more and more into just, you know, what do you want to talk about? But at first, she's asking them, how would things have been different for you as a person if you had been born a man? Would you have wanted to be an actress?
So
none of them said yes.
I found it interesting because actors talking about their profession usually is interesting. A lot of what they had to say, like, these are not intellectual theorists, they're just people talking about their feelings.
Except for Jane Fonda, who's kind of an intellectual theorist.
True, and she had more organized thoughts than many of them. A lot of what they had to say seemed very silly, but it was interesting in spite of that, just as capturing a particular moment in history.
We've actually talked about this one aspect of it, because we couldn't resist resist, but several women talked about how if they had been born male, they would have liked to have become sailors.
Well, two French women said that, and I was like, was this actually an option in France when these women were young, or was this based on French movies that they were watching?
Yeah, and it's certainly not based on a real understanding of what it would be to sign on as a sailor. I don't think it would be one long round of whoopee. I think it would be nasty, and you might even get flogged.
Well, one of them was the great Celine and Julie actress.
Yeah, Juliette Berthaud.
Who also talked about how she would have liked to have lived on the streets, but that was too challenging for her as well as a woman. But what was interesting in what she said is that in her own mind, she became an actress because she couldn't explore the world as she could have done if only she were a man.
Right.
So she was going to stay at home and explore all of these aspects of reality through cinema.
Which is fair. And she also gives us a weird insight into the behind the scenes at Celine and Julie Go Boating, where she described Rivette as an honorary woman who let the actresses chart their course for the most part, except that they didn't want anything to do with the structuring element of the film, which was the haunted house. Hard to imagine what that movie would have been without that part of it.
Well, that's why you need an external eye.
Yeah.
And can't just improvise an entire movie unless, I guess, you're Bob Hope and Bing Crosby. Like, I guess the main points to think about here... acting to this day, certainly movie acting, although it's mentioned in the movie, and I'm sure it's true that theater was no better, and I'm sure still isn't, but it used to be, you know, more of an actual thing that people did and became famous for. Even now, it is a profession that is harder for women.
Yeah.
Not as many parts, not as many well-written parts, and you are obsolete faster. I don't think any of that has changed. We could talk about more interesting parts and how that's changed over the years. This moment, the 70s, I mean, some of these interventions had to take place. Also, Laura Mulvey's writing, Molly Haskell's book, because it was an absolute nadir for roles for women in movies.
Certainly in the new Hollywood, it was a bunch of film nerds. You know, all the directors had been male in the 30s and 40s as well, but they weren't so obsessed with their own male things at the time, or they were not allowed to be, so they made movies starring women. And when you get the 70s guys come in, as most of these women are talking about, like, it got worse in terms of opportunities for women to play interesting roles.
Horrors and boring housewives.
Shirley MacLaine, now she wasn't interviewed by Seyrig, right? It's like archival footage.
Yeah, that's what
it's
it looks
a weird,
like,
you know, interpolation there. But apropos, she's talking about, well, her theories about what happened was that when you couldn't show sex scenes, they had to have women doing things outside of the bedroom. Once you could show sex scenes, and that's all women are asked to do in movies anymore, and that's where she stands on it. I'm not sure if that's exactly what the problem is, but the reason she's thinking that way or thinking along those lines or trying to make sense of it is because she is speaking to the very real dearth of opportunities for women to play leading roles
anymore. Yeah, with a context like that, you suddenly understand why as complicated a figure as Cassavetes becomes a kind of hero of creating women's roles. And I remember him specifically saying something about Woman Under the Influence, about wanting to make a movie about a woman who, I don't remember his exact wording, but what if we thought of women as not just prostitutes, but of of people who are characters?
What we get is a lot of talk about buddy movies.
And a lot of homophobic talk about buddy movies.
Yeah. Yeah, that doesn't really stand up these days.
But that's another thing that was happening in the 70s, yes. Directors found that, you know, like the idea in Road to Morocco that the woman actually is just a mirage who is simply there to mediate the homosocial relationship of the men, that you could just take the woman out and nobody would care.
Pretty much.
Or completely sidelined. She's already completely sidelined in Road to Morocco.
But it gets even worse when you have these Catherine Ross parts.
Even worse. It can get even worse.
Which Cassidy and the
And then also the men can, you know, just as the women are actually saying, as homosexuality becomes a tiny bit more accepted, the men actually can express warmth towards each other.
So they don't need to express warmth to women anymore, and therefore there are no roles for women at all. That's what it felt like, at any rate, to be a woman in that profession in 1975.
And then we get a version although a smarter version of the Bechdel test, because I've said one of my problems with the Bechdel test, well, two problems with the Bechdel test. First of all, at least if we're talking about studio-era Hollywood movies, particularly the genres we like, which is melodrama, or relationship-focused melodrama, 80% of the time when two men in a movie like that are talking to each other, they are also talking about the woman.
Yeah.
So that's just kind of a structural issue within romantic stories, that when two people of the same gender talk in those movies, they're usually romantic rivals.
Or one's a sidekick who's there to help the hero talk about his feelings.
True, true. The hero or the heroine. And then my other problem with it is that you can have, and we were talking about this off mic too, you can have scenes between two women talking about a man that are nevertheless very interesting, as Ozu does in so many of his movies. He always has some kind of great relationship between the Setsuko Hera character and another female character, but usually they are talking because those movies have romantic plots.
Yeah, well, she's dealing with, you know, this idea of having to get married a lot of the time. Mm-hmm. That's going to be on her mind when she talks to people.
The way Delphine Seyrig puts it is, have you ever had an opportunity to play a scene with another woman where you express warm feelings? And I think that is a better test, probably, of how female relationships are being represented, and women in general, in movies.
Des scènes chaleureuses, yes.
And that's certainly the case. Ozu certainly passes that test with flying colors. Many, many, many a movie would not, and certainly not a lot of movies being made in the 1970s. None of the women, other than Celine and Julie, none of the women could think of experiences like that.
No, they were pretty at a loss when they tried to search their memory banks.
Well, here's another question, like it's kind of a perennial question for me that the movie brought up, as well as materials like Molly Haskell's 1970s book From Reverence to Rape, although I disagree with a lot in that book, it was nevertheless worth reading. The question of why were things better during the studio era? Why did they get so bad? And have they gotten much better for actresses, for creation of female characters in American film and, you know, more broadly, world cinema, which of course has gotten slightly larger since Haskell was writing, you know, things that we get to see in North America. Because when you look back at the top box office attractions, there was never a time where women dominated. It was slightly more equal in the silent era and 30s, but mostly the top box office attractions have always been men. So my first question being, why did the studios even bother creating any roles for women? Why did they even try to make female stars? Why didn't they just take note of the fact that they're going to get more mileage out of the male stars and just make every movie about men? I guess that wasn't the thinking then.
No, the thinking was to make movies for every segment of the population, because everyone went to the cinema.
But that thinking didn't last.
Because people stopped going to the cinema in such numbers, right? Now you know the demographic everyone is looking to appeal to is, you know, skews young, and they're definitely trying to attract young males.
Yeah, I mean, that's what everyone says about the turning point of the 70s and the creation of the blockbuster film, and which has just turned into the superhero movie.
Sure has.
With a few token female superheroes.
Women dominated the movie audience in the 30s and 40s. You know, they definitely were a larger percentage of people that went to see films.
And yet still the top box office attractions were usually men.
Sure, but that doesn't mean that all those women's pictures were not seen by a lot of people and brought in profits to the studio. We know they did.
Yeah, but as I'm saying, like, eventually it was figured out that you could leave the women out of the picture.
Yeah, because it's different now.
And you could leave the women out of the audience.
Women go to superhero movies too.
Well, that's the other thing, that women will watch men, but men won't watch women.
That's definitely something that persists.
Now, something that has gotten a little better since the 70s, that is relevant to the making of this documentary and some of the things that are talked about in it, is that slightly more women are making movies. Also, among indie directors, not all of the men are only making movies about men. There are some interesting parts available out there in the, you know, higher budget indie film world for actresses and for actresses over the age of 40.
Yeah.
It's still slim pickings, but they don't all have to go into horror movies like Betty Davis and Joan Crawford.
Yeah, and that is referenced in the documentary.
Yeah, can you think of a woman over 50 who's still a box office attraction, basically?
Yeah, and they could really only think of Betty Davis, but she's always in these horror movies now. One of the byproducts of the film is that it makes me definitely want to do a Jane Fonda actress spotlight, so we'll put her on there. We haven't talked about her much, and we hadn't really taken any special pains to get her onto our schedule. I really want to see Julia, which is a movie that she talks about a lot because she was making it at the time of the documentary.
Right.
She plays Lillian Hellman.
That actually is a movie where women got to express warm feelings toward each other, and apparently that created lesbian panic.
Yeah, it did, according to Jane Fonda. So yeah, definitely see it when it comes to your town, restored version, because yeah, I can't even imagine what it was like before. The second half of the film is plagued by, you know, a dual track. You have to deal with voiceover by someone who doesn't even speak French very well, translating the English person's speech, and then you have to read the subtitles, I guess. We had a special guest, Nicole Fernandez-Ferrer, who is the director of the Centre Audiovisuel Simone de Beauvoir in France. She was a collaborator with Seyrig in the 80s, and she had a hand in restoring this film, and she lamented the fact that they can't get rid of this overdubbed because it's just stuck on the track. Like, yeah, it can't be separated out without losing the footage. So they did their best. Certainly something to see, a little snapshot of what it would have been like to try to ply your trade as a woman in American and French films at the time.
One of the more amusing stories that was told in the documentary by Louise Fletcher.
Wonderful actress.
I don't even know if you could say it really has to do with being a woman, because I think a short man could have a similar problem.
True.
Although, I suppose there have been more, I guess. Dustin Hoffman was a short man. He didn't seem to stop him from becoming a movie star.
Alan Ladd.
Yeah, there's been some short men. I don't know how many giantly tall women there have been who are movie stars.
Well, it's always a problem in the old days. Alexis Smith, a lot of the stories about her were that...
It is easier to make the man taller.
Yeah, get him on a box.
Than to make the woman shorter. But anyhow, yeah, so she tells the story of being asked 11 times to fly out to, I don't know, LA, I guess, by the same producer to be up for a part. Every time he saw her, he asked her how tall she was, and she had to be sent back with no part again.
Yeah, and then she finally decides, okay, you know what? I'm going to put a line on the wall, and that's going to remind you whenever you think about me and a part, this is how tall I am, so don't even bother summoning me.
The only story I can think of, really, where you had the short actor plus the tall actress problem is the Sid Charisse and Gene Kelly situation in Singin' in the Rain.
Right.
The sequence where they had to figure out how to do a dance for the two of them where it would not be apparent that she was towering over him in her heels.
Yeah. Millie Perkins was interesting. You know, she... Did you... know her? I only know her from Diary of Anne Frank. She plays Anne Frank. She's the one who had, you know, the mother. She didn't want to put her in a nursing home. And
that was completely off topic.
It was crazy. It was really entertaining. Crazy, yeah. Yeah. Anyway, yeah, definitely something to see. India Song, Marguerite Duras.
This is something to see. Absolutely. Oh my God. Okay, so...
We do have this on the schedule, so we're not going to go in great depth here.
Wow. Wow. I knew this was going to be difficult. So we'd seen one Duras before.
Nathalie Granger, which was really good. Yeah. Really entertaining.
Yes. That movie was a little more accessible because it had an interlude, a comic interlude involving Gérard Depardieu as a washing machine salesman.
Oh, it's so good.
That really made me warm to the film more. But the rest of it was all pretty much like India Song. Just vacant zombies and a lot of left to right camera panning. I think I counted like about 7 walkouts. It was a packed theater, which I was like, holy shit, I bet these people don't know what they're in for. I think I counted 7 walkouts, but a couple of them were probably bathroom breaks. Which is insane. Don't do that. Especially not for a movie like this. I think I liked it.
Oh, I thought it was really good.
Yeah, you liked it? It was so demanding. It was so formally demanding. I sometimes have trouble staying awake for afternoon movies anyway, no matter what they are. And this was quite a challenge. I really wish I'd brought a coffee in. But I also don't wish that I had, because the experience of watching this movie, which it wasn't a great print. They really need to restore it, but...
Well, it's a 35mm, so we have no idea what state some prints are in.
Sure, it needs a restoration anyway, but it was kind of grainy, and then also a lot of the shots are very, very dark, and then there would be these endless still shots of a segment of a room, and the movie is so hypnotic. Incantatory is the word that's brought out for it a lot. It is so hypnotic in its slowness and stasis and rhythms that I started hallucinating. I swear to God, I started hallucinating things on the screen in the darkness. Particularly, there was this one moment, I think it was the moment when I realized that that room we were seeing was in a mirror,
right,
where it felt like the incense that's burning in every single indoor scene turned into Delphine Seyrig's character as she walked through the door into the room that's actually a mirror, and my mind was just blown.
It's in a very strange relationship with Marienbad, for sure.
Marienbad and also The growing sense of evil felt very Celine and Julie-esque. I can't remember what year they are relatively, but...
Well, it's after Celine and Julie.
It is? Yeah, it felt like it was in relationship to both Renee, who of course she worked with as a screenwriter on Hiroshima, Mon Amour, and Rivette. One unfavorable review of it that I found online said that Renee exhibited more joy in their filmmaking than Marguerite Duras does, or more of the joy of filmmaking. And that's one way to put it. Another way to put it is that those movies seem Hollywood mainstream compared to this.
Well, is there not joy in the moment where the vice counsel begins to scream maniacally, and then someone asks, is that the vice counsel of France screaming?
Well, that's like after...
Well, yes, it is.
That's like 15 minutes after he starts screaming.
Yeah, amazing.
When somebody asks that.
What an incredible moment. I don't know if there's ever been... There's never been a moment like that in film. She has done something completely unique there. To have this incredibly quiet, hypnotic film all of a sudden go crazy
and
sonically.
Turn into what it's been threatening to turn into the whole time, which is a horror movie.
I don't think it is a great showcase, you know, for any actor other than maybe the vice counsel.
Apparently it was Michael Lonsdale apparently said that was his favorite part.
He's such a wonderful actor. Everything you see him in, he always makes his mark, although not quite like this. I mean, even in Remains of the Day, he plays the French ambassador in that one, who just keeps talking about soaking his feet. He's just hilarious in everything, but also can be very intense.
I don't quite agree. A lot is going on with Delphine Seyrig's face.
But we can't really see it. Like, there are no close-ups.
That's true, but it's also partly the condition the film was in.
That's true.
Well, I mean, we need to see it again at least once.
It's very meaningful that she wanted to be in this movie, obviously.
No, but listen, apparently, and when we do the movie, we're going to have to look up what the fuck Marguerite Duras thought she was doing, because she employed some very unusual methods to make this film, and one of them was having because the actors don't speak their dialogue at any point, we failed to mention.
Well, it's like Chris Marker, you know, in that sense.
So the dialogue that is delivered by the characters, she was playing to them while they were performing the scene. What Delphine Seyrig is doing is she's listening to her character's emotions as she's acting them.
Brilliant filmmaking, I think. It's just hard to see as you watch it.
She's far less enigmatic in this one than she is in Marienbad.
Well, yeah, of course, but that's the whole point of her character in Marienbad, is to be enigmatic.
Well, let's switch over to Marienbad now. Like, I do think it's a better showcase for her acting than Marienbad.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. It's a better showcase, and it certainly seems to be a movie about, you know, that Marienbad character maybe having some kind of warped agency where she has none in Marienbad, right? That seems to be maybe part of the relationship between the two films.
Maybe.
Marienbad, L'année dernière, Marienbad, you know, one of the all-time movie house classics.
We've seen this before at TIFF, and did you see it with me for the first time?
Yeah, I had never seen it, actually.
You'd
before,
never seen that,
like, 2013.
Or Celine and Julie.
No, yeah, those were some of the first movies that we watched together.
There were a couple of walkouts for this one, too.
Yeah, that's...
That's unfortunate.
Strange.
So I want to say about last year at Marienbad.
Just very high level, again, because we will be talking about it in depth when we do our...
It's kind of like Inland Empire, in that I've never really tried to figure out what's going on in it, and every time I watch it, I feel like I glimpse maybe a little bit more.
Well, this time all I could think about was Carnival of Souls, and once I started thinking about that, I started to think that they're both dead in the movie.
I mean, it's the kind of movie that could make you start thinking things like that.
It's such an interesting echo between the two, right? Carnival of Souls comes out 1 year later. I don't know if Herc Harvey had seen.
I kind of doubt it.
But
that there's an influence there.
Such an interesting similarity. You know, that weird music
is
almost the
music,
same.
Yeah, that's true. The horror organ music, or the silent movie organ music.
Yeah, I feel like there's a lot to say about the relationship between those two films. And, you know, once you start thinking that way.
Well, they do seem to be trapped in some kind of hell.
Yeah.
That's all I can really say.
But as you say, Delphine Seyrig, you know, we don't get any of her subjectivity in the film.
This is another thing I was thinking as I was watching it to think about when I see the movie again, like kind of putting a pin in it, which is, who is this character in herself, if there is one? But also, who is she supposed to represent as a male fantasy? I'm not even sure if I understand that.
No, it's very hard to understand what's going on. She doesn't have any expressed emotions, really, about anything that's going on. on, except that she doesn't remember.
She seems to not want to leave her husband. She seems to be in the thrall of this sort of sinister magician husband, but to want to remain there rather than trade his thrall for the thrall of this sinister suitor?
Man with the Italian accent.
The suitor might be more sinister than the husband.
Well, he definitely is dealing with some issues, and
he's one of the things that clicked for me that I have read about the film that was Renee's intention. He's sort of mind raping her.
Again, we're seeing it almost entirely through his perspective, or we're hearing it through his perspective, because he's narrating most of the film as he talks to her and talks to us. And he's not in control of the situation, though.
Is anybody in control of the situation? Because you think the husband is, but then he doesn't really seem to be at the end.
No. But our protagonist, this guy, you know, his big preoccupation is, you know, did I take her by force or not, right? He talks about this several times. Like, we get these scenes where it seems pretty clear in one recounting of it that he just comes in and sexually assaults her. But then he's like, no, that's not what happened. I didn't take her by force. And so he doesn't remember what happened.
He doesn't seem to know.
No, and he doesn't either.
Well, the more he talks to her about it, the more
worried he gets.
Yeah, and then he doesn't remember.
Yeah.
But, yeah, the more the narrative he's trying to create slips away from him. But also, at certain points, he seems to just, in a very sort of turn-of-the-screw governess way, seems to just project his narrative of emotional violence right into her mind.
Yeah.
And then she starts to think that she might remember. But then there's also the photographs, which seem to be evidence of something.
Yeah.
See, I have no idea. So this movie, I think, we had it in the wrong place in our schedule, and I hope you've now moved it to the correct place, which is to be with our reading of the Sontag essay.
Against interpretation.
Yeah, not interpreting films that do not themselves know what is true in what they're presenting, like what is true in the narrative.
All right, well, leave it at that. The schedule will be switched around a little bit, but India Song and Marienbad will both be on the schedule, I think, in 2026. Next week on the podcast, it's a 4-movie extravaganza, our January special subject. It's part 2 of Fred and Ginger. We're going to pick up where we left off and talk about the final 4 films of the RKO series with these 2 dancing greats. We'll be doing Follow the Fleet, Shall We Dance, Carefree, and The Story of Vernon and Irene Castle. I think we'll also have 4 films that we've seen in the Seyrig series by next week, unless we get sick again. We look forward to seeing you then.
See you then.